Hello, welcome back. In today's episode, we're going to be painting a lovely little sunset scene over a lagoon. And I hope through this painting to help you develop your skill in judging the right wetness of the paper with the right paint consistency in your brush to create just the right mark in your painting. Hi, my name is Joe Cartwright. Welcome to my studio. My aim with these videos is to help you paint better watercolours. And remember, if you like what you see, please subscribe and hit the notification bell so you'll be informed of each new video I produce. The only drawing we need to do for this is a single line that's parallel to the edge of the paper. A little bit more than a third of the way up, and that'll be the distant shore of the lagoon. Basically, I want more sky than water, but I need enough room for the water to create some lovely reflections. So, as with all the other paintings we've done in this series, to date, we've just been using a size of 11 inches by about 7.5 inches, and I'm using Archer's cold press paper. I'm going to wet the back, and this will help keep the painting flat. This particular piece of paper is 300 GSM, so it can absorb a lot of moisture. And the colours we'll be using today are the same three colours we've used in the other paintings we've done with these videos, and that's Permanent Rose, Winsor Blue Red Shade, and Winsor Lemon. They're all Winsor and Newton colours. There we go. Just let that sit there, and I'll mix the colours that we're going to need. We're going to have a small amount of blue. Because each of these three colours we mix will be used in the rest of the painting, you can overmix at this stage, so mix more than what you think you'll need. Probably the one I'm going to use the least of is the orange, but I'll use a lot of the blue and the red. So if we start with the blue, so this is a sunset scene. So in a typical sunset, one of the gradations you have is going from a deep blue to the red to a little bit of orange. And a bit more red. But it's not a bright blue, so if we add a small amount of yellow, the Winsor Lemon, that will turn the bright blue into more of a greyish colour. So grey colours, basically colours mixed with all three primary colours. And that will do. And because I've been limiting costs for this course, I've just said you need one size 12 brush and one size 8 brush. In reality, you'll end up accumulating multiple brushes, and if you've got, say, two or three size 12 brushes, then you don't have to keep cleaning them every time you go from one colour to the other. Even then, you don't always have to clean your brush, and you'll see when I clean the brush and when I don't clean the brush. So there's a nice red. And then for the orange, clean some of the green off the top of my Winsor Lemon. Let's mix a Winsor Lemon and very soon we'll be moving to my full palette. I think by now, if you've been following along, you've either decided watercolour is for you or it's not. And in the full palette, I have about 13 colours, and it makes the job of mixing colours so much easier. I want this to have a lot more yellow than red in it, so maybe a little bit more yellow here. And that's good. Okay, so let's wet the back of this again. Lift that up, wet the board. All right, now we're going to let's paint our sky, and I'm going to have some like a hill here with some trees on it, and another hill here with some trees on that. This will be a bigger shape than that, so that the gap between them will be somewhere in this area. If we start with the sky, maybe that's a bit too dark. I'll add a bit of water to it. Watercolour does dry lighter, so you can afford to be a bit braver when you first paint the sky. So now I'm going with some red. Here we go. Yeah, a little bit of orange, don't need to clean the brush. Now I'll clean the brush. Pick up the clean orange. Now, this is still drying fairly fast, so I'm going to get my spray bottle. And so I hold the bottle up in a vertical position, spray so that all the big droplets land over there and only the lightest droplets land on white paper. And that's just to keep this area workable. And I'd like a bit more blue in this sky, so I'm going to pick up some of this dark colour and add a little bit more blue to it. And just a little bit of the red. There we go. Then quickly add a bit more red. My aim is to get a nice clean transition between each colour. A little bit of orange. There we go. So here we've got a smooth transition from the deep blue to the pinks into the orange. And we let that sit there and let that dry. So I'm going to have a hill here with some trees sprouting from it, and then a bigger hill here. And for that, I'm going to be using mostly this dark color here that I may make even darker. Now, you can see how this, as we're talking, the painting is continuing to develop. So all that paint and moisture is flowing down the paper. If you wanted this area to be brighter, what's happening here is some of the blues and the reds are flowing over the orange. If you wanted a brighter sunset, then rather than painting it this way, you could paint it this way. So you do your bright colours first, like the orange, then the red, then the blue, and that will give you a lighter sky. It doesn't really matter for this exercise. Now, if I was to pick up some of this paint here, and pick it up with a very drippy brush, if I try and paint the, see how it's totally uncontrolled, right? It's flowing down. So you have to be aware of just how wet the moisture is in your brush and how wet the paper is. This still has quite a lot of shine on it, which says it's got a lot of surface moisture, and so there's very little control when you touch that paper with this wet paint. So what do? You either wait for this to dry some more, which is a good thing to do, and the other thing you can do is mix a thicker mix of your paint. So I'm going to dry this part of my palette for now. And if I pick up some of this paint and just put one load there, and now I'm not going to pick up any more moisture. I'm just going to pick up some paint. And you can see how this is sort of thickening up. This stage is very close to house paint. And because this area is still wet, then I can use this thicker paint and it will still retain a lot of its translucency. So we're going to have a smaller hill here. Let's paint. And you can see how now it's still flowing, but not to the same extent as my previous brush mark. There. And I'm going to have a bigger hill here coming down like that. This is purely out of my imagination, so you can paint these all you want, and it's just a great exercise. There we go. I'm going to let a little bit of dark colour run there. That can be part of the lagoon shore. Now, so right now you can see how these are sort of what I would call like a furry edge. A small amount of the paint's flowed up, most of it has flowed down. I've painted this in such a way to allow some of the underpainting to show through, and that's just a hint at gullies and things like that on the hillside. And now we need to wait for this area to dry for me to be able to put in the silhouette of some of these trees. Let me see if I can somehow angle this enough that you can see. You can see how shiny that is. That's telling you it's still too wet. You can get the hairdryer onto this to dry that. I try not to do that because sometimes the hairdryer can disturb the surface of the paper, and I'll just discuss that in a future video. But what I want to do in this case is to have some areas where I have a more sharply defined edge, and other areas that are a softer edge, so that the foliage that I paint up here has a nice transition between the sharper edge of the foliage and the softer edges that are hidden amongst the hillside. So because this is quite a small painting, I'll just get my size 8 brush and we need to mix some more. Okay, so again, we've got this darker mixture tested, and you test it by pressing lightly and dragging the brush, and that gives you a better idea of the colour. I want that to be a little bit thicker still, because some parts of this are still quite damp. And obviously, to make it thicker, you just add some more paint, but no more water. You also have to be careful that you don't have wet areas in your palette that flow into it and accidentally darken your paint. Okay, let's try it again. There we go. So now, firstly, I've only got a brush that's probably about a third full of paint, and you can see how we're getting sort of a semi-soft edge, meaning it's not as furry as this, and it's a little bit better defined, which says we're close to being able to paint this. In fact, what I might do, let's test it here. And the nature of watercolour is the water's always flowing down, so this part of the painting will tend to be drier than this part of the painting. So when you place a mark here, you can tell that if that's starting to look like it might be have a sharp edge, then there's a good chance this area above is dry enough for you to create the marks. So I'm going to pick up some of this paint. I think it's dry enough for now. And then just using the side of the brush, leaving lots of little gaps for bird holes. And then maybe come down here. Don't get too concerned if the first time you try this it doesn't work. The key is to practice, and that's how you learn. There we go. So that's nice. And this area should be just about the same. Let's start down here. Again, my brush is not bouncing back to a full point, and that tells you there's not... it's not a fully loaded brush, it doesn't drip when I do that. And I want these trees to be in different shapes. I'll make this one here a bit bigger. Then I'll go to just a few quick marks. It's just hinting at undulations or other trees in this hill, but primarily it's just at the edge here that you'll see trees. Okay. All right, and that's good enough for this painting. Maybe I can make this one just a little bit more sharply defined. And we'll darken some areas. That'll do. And now we can work on the water. Before we start painting the water, we need to remix a little bit of this orange. Now, the nature of reflections is generally reflections of a light object will be darker, and reflections of a dark object will be lighter. So here, the reflections of these dark hills could be a little bit lighter than what they are. In a sunset scene, there's not always a really great, a big differentiation between the two. And also the colours will be a little bit duller. Again, because it's a sunset scene, the differentiation isn't as great. So let's pick up this yellow and some red. There's too much blue on this yellow, so I'll clean that off. And the blue was making it go green. And so if you have blue, yellow, and green, so blue, yellow, and red, you end up with a brown, and I don't, rather than an orange. That's what happened there. So I'll just clear that out. So just a little puddle of yellow, a little bit of red. That'll do. And it will be slightly duller than that. Just a bit of blue. Because the reason it's duller is because the water's not a perfect mirror. Some of the reflection is absorbed in the water, and also the water itself is not crystal clear like a mirror, and the colour of the water merges with the colour of the reflection. There we go. I'll just run this all the way across. I'm going to leave little gaps. Just think of them as little reflections as the waves lap up on the shore. And then we've got some orange, then it moves into the reds, and then we have a bit of the blue, just a hint. Let's extend this a bit. And the red. Very quick brush marks and let the paint flow. If you leave little white bits like that, that's great. That just adds a little bit of sparkle on the water. Some more blue across, not that way, this way. And clean the brush and dry it so I don't dilute the mixture, and I want a bit more red here. I don't want so much orange. There we go. Great. And now we've got our reflections. Now we need this to be a bit more watery. This is too thick. So I'll pick up some of this paint. Just run it down and let it flow. Same here. And obviously you have to get the timing right. If this was drying and you started seeing a hint of just a hint that maybe it's not going to flow, you might need to get your spray bottle out to keep it workable. Or you might, if you aren't comfortable with doing that, then you've got to let it dry completely, and then you get a very soft brush with crystal clear water, and then you re-wet this area. Let the moisture be absorbed for about 30 seconds or a minute, and then you can do exactly what we're doing now. There we go. The orange there was creating a bit of a sharp edge that I didn't like, so I'm just going to throw in a few little tiny ripples. The water, There we go. Great. And I might get rid of some of this shoreline. Great. And this could be it for this exercise, but I want to throw in some birds and maybe some grasses in the foreground, but I need the water and the sky to be totally dry for that. Before I dry this, I can, because this paper has sort of lost its shine, but it's still damp, I can use this opportunity to, if I pick up a credit card and along the shore, I can throw in some, it could be a fence or something to break up that edge. Again, this is purely from my imagination, so it doesn't matter. I can do whatever I want with it. All right, now I'll dry that. This is just about finished now. I'll put my mat around it. And all I'm going to do is throw in a bird or two. They vary their size and their angle. I could throw another one here. And if we paint the bird like that, and if you leave a gap and just put a little flick like that and then drag it down, you create the bird flying over the water, leaving and with its little reflection underneath. And then just pick up some of this thicker paint. And we'll just sign it here. There we go. And if you want, you can create many of these. You can add a little bit more detail along the water's edge. You could put, reeds or whatever in the foreground, but I think for this exercise I'm happy with this, and it's something that you can do multiple of them. Remember, I tested this, my paint consistency, right in the middle of this hill, realizing or knowing that if it was too wet, I could I would be painting through it anyway, so I wouldn't actually damage the painting. And then I thickened the paint. Also, in doing that, I also waited for some of the paint to dry a little bit. Then I tested it again. If you test lower, judging on whether the paint flows or starts to just a hint at a hard edge, that generally tells you that the paper higher up is going to be dry enough to give you some of these more defined edges, while giving you some of these smaller edges down below. I hope you've enjoyed that. It's quite a simple painting, but if you let the watercolor flow, play with these consistencies, you can create some magical effects. See you for the next painting.